Today we're continuing in the book of Acts, and we are now in chapter 4, and today we're going to specifically be looking at verses 32 through 37, spiritual unity and generosity. Does this sound familiar? How many people were here a few weeks ago? This may sound very familiar, but I'm going to tell you right now, if it was important enough for Luke to mention it twice in the first four chapters, I figure, who am I to say no? So we're going to talk about the church again that shared everything they had. And it is very interesting that just recently he just talked about this and now he's talking about it again. So evidently it was something that was very important in the early church that he wanted to make sure that we understood. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them, all that there were no needy persons among them. For from time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone who had need. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold the field he owned and brought the money and put it at the apostles' feet. Let us pray. Lord, we're thankful for your word today. We pray that it convicts us, that it cuts through the very marrow of our bone, Lord. Your word is not designed to fall on false ears, but it was designed to not only for us to hear, but to change us, to transform us. So Lord, we pray that your word does transform us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I may have asked this question before, but it is an interesting question. Anybody ever worked for two bosses at the same time?
They were Jewish bosses.
No. Were they totally in agreement?
No.
Kind of, it can kind of create disunity and dysfunction within the office space when you work with two bosses. Janae worked, I know, in a dentist office, and there were two dentists, and they both had different ways of doing things. Mm-hmm. And so you had to remember when you worked with the one, you did it this way, you worked with the other, you did it a different way, try to keep it separate. When I was in the military, my supervisor was the chief of the intelligence division, but then I was attached to another unit working intelligence. And so I was kind of working for that colonel over there, but the one who wrote my report was over here. And they were two totally different people. Actually, the one I wished where I was working, he would have been writing my report. But anyway, such as it is. But they did have different ways of looking at things and different ways of viewing. And so this comes to leadership in the church. Okay? And we're looking at this scripture today, and it's talking about the unity and how critical not only is our church of one mind and one body, but it can only be that if our leadership is also of one mind and one body. Just as you can't work for two bosses, you have to have not a dysfunctional leadership group, but a functional leadership group that is together, that is in unity, not in spiritual unity, that acts as one. And fortunately, we have that here in this church, and I'm blessed by the elders and deacons that we do have.
Amen.
Spiritual unity in the church is absolutely essential for the effective functioning of the church, okay? We have to have a sense of loyalty. We have to have a sense of commitment to God and to one another, okay? You know, we keep talking about this body, and we're all different parts of the body. And when we come together, we make a whole body, okay? So it's important that we come together to worship together as one. It's important for glorifying God, but it's also important for us to help make us whole and to be in unity with God. And love for God also means love for His Word. And if we're going to be a successful church, and what does the word successful mean? It probably depends on who you ask for a church. But I don't believe when God looks at what a successful church is, he's looking at every seat filled by a body, okay? I think he's looking at our lives being transformed, our lives being changed. Are people witnessing? Is the Holy Spirit working through their lives? Are people being changed by the Word of God, by His Holy Spirit? And without that love and that unity, we won't survive. This church will not continue to function. And we look around today and there's not, you know, we have a lot of people missing today. But are we more than two? We're two or more gathered, right? We have church. In Acts, and he says, all the believers were one. One. One in heart, one in mind. And none of their possessions did they see as their own. They saw all the possessions they had was God's. And so when you have that viewpoint, when you change, oh, I hate that word paradigm shift, but when you change the way you look at things and you see that it's not yours anymore, it all belongs to God. It makes it very easy to share and to help people out. And it makes it very easy to be generous. I think it's hard to be generous if the Holy Spirit's not working in you or in this church, in this body. And they eliminated poverty at that time, because if they saw someone in need, they sought God. Prayed about it, and then they did what God told them to do. Whenever you get, windfall, but whenever, say your tax return comes back, or you get all of a sudden a bonus or some money that you don't normally have, do you seek God on what to do with that money? Or do you already have it planned out before you get it, what you're going to spend it on? And maybe you don't want to seek God because your heart's set on what you're going to spend it on. But we have to remember, God knows what's best for us. And we're blinded often. We really don't know what's best for us. And God may very well confirm what you think you should spend it on is what you should spend it on. Or he may reveal something else. But if we don't seek him, we don't know. But during this time, no one suffered. Because again, they saw everything that they had, all their possessions were from God. And we need to make this point, or I need to make this point very clearly. It was totally voluntary. Now, you may sit there and realize it, but in other cultures, like say in Taiwan, when people become Christians, they want to know how much it's going to cost them to come to church. Because they're used to going to the temple. And if somebody prays for them, they pay them. Somebody blesses their car, they pay them. Okay? See, we know we come to church, and if we give, it's all voluntary. There's no expectation on what you're to give. I don't stand up here and say, if you can't give $20, then you should not be here. Okay? No. It's between you and the Lord on what you give tribute to the ministry. And their sharing was all voluntary. Okay. And then here's another point we need to make. They didn't give up everything. We read that and thought, oh, they just, you know, it was kind of like the banditos. You join them and you sign everything over to them. No, that wasn't the way. No, they still kept some personal property. It was just that when a need came up, they prayed and say, well, you know, I have this extra property. I'm not really doing anything with it. You know, I could donate that to the ministry. We could sell it and give the money to the ministry. Or I have this I don't need. I can sell it, give the ministry. You know, we do yard sales. We donate items to give to ministry, raise money for ministry, right? It wasn't a requirement. But here's the big thing. Boy, it was an attraction. And I don't know if it's so much of an attraction, say, let's go join that church because they're going to give us stuff. But I think what the attraction was is generosity, the compassion, the love that they had for one another. That's what I think the attraction was. And out of that love and compassion, blessing just naturally flowed. Giving just naturally flowed out of that hearts of generosity and unity. Let's not forget that the church's foundation was prayer. That's what opened hearts to generosity. That's what opened their hearts to giving. That's what opened their hearts to sharing the gospel with others, the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the message. Was because, and just what I said, when a need arose, they sought the Lord. They prayed about it. They were following the will of God. Church then depended on prayer. This church needs to depend on prayer. I can't say right now that we are totally dependent on prayer. I'd like to. We're moving, I think, in that direction. That's where I think we need to be. But we're not there yet. But a church that depends on prayer experiences blessing. And they experienced blessing. We'll see how they experienced. Multitudes came to the church as a result. I asked Carrie to come up here for just a few minutes because she and Janae were up at this conference up in Colorado Springs a couple of weeks ago that was focused on prayer and about the church. So I asked her just to share a few things on why it's so important our church is dependent on prayer.
You know, I hate to talk. So he's right. This conference was talking about that the nation is kind of at a crisis right now. We could go this way or that way really easily. And all of these people, there were 1,000 or more people there, all have a heart for turning every small church into this house of prayer, to getting back to that root. And, you know, one of the things that not only his scripture is up there, but you see it repeatedly, that they were in prayer, that the disciples, you know, assigned to other people like Stephen to take care of the running of the things so that they could devote themselves to prayer and the ministry of the Word of God. And there's a lot of things we want to see happening in this church. And there's a few of us that are continually praying together. And I'm not saying you guys are not praying, but there is something about coming together on this property prior to any service, prior to day preaching, prior to the sermon, prior to Wednesday nights, prior to the Bible study. And we just focus on not our own needs, although those come up, but the prayer of the church and this evangelism that we want to do, because revival is going to come out of these places like this, mm-hmm. not the big mega churches. Mm-hmm. The big mega churches are, you know, they're serving their own needs, basically. Mm-hmm. But if there's any kind of a fire in your heart, you know, we know that we get absorbed in our own things, and there's nothing wrong with that. But as a body that we say, we know the body needs to take care of its own health as well, the body of the church. So we have a lot of literature, we have a lot of websites and things where even not just Janae and I leading, but that we can tap into to pray for the nation, pray for the churches. And you'll be hearing more about it. And Janae talked about a little bit about that 15 minutes that Doug Sheets is doing. That's all things you can do, but there's tons of things to pray for, you know. They talked a lot about the generation that was lost in the 60s. And that we have the millennials right now that can be lost unless we fight for them. I mean, this is our role as the older generation, to fight for them. to bring them back. And there's a huge bunch of them that want to do that. I mean, I was amazed at the number of young people that were there. And it was awesome. But, you know, we need to make a concerted effort. You know, not just a little tagline in the prayers. And I'm guilty of this too. I mean, I'm not preaching to y'all like I don't need this, because I do. I'm guilty of just as an afterthought, thinking about the nation or thinking about the church. You know, and it's like we need to do, he says he doesn't like paradigm, and Lou Engle, who's the one that has the heart for this evangelism, he has changed the word to prayerdime. Prayerdime shift. I mean, we need a prayerdime shift. Amen. In the nation, starting with our small churches.
Amen.
Thank you. What do you think? Do you think this church is filled with the Holy Spirit?
Yeah.
It is now.
You know, there are churches gosh, what's this church in Bethel?
Reading.
Bethel Church in Reading.
Yes.
Anyway, where they actually see manifestations of the Holy Spirit in the church. That'd be something, a manifestation, a cloud, a mist. We can feel manifestations by our body getting
rain.
Warm or hot or rain. There's a lot of different manifestations.
Healings,
yeah. We've had people come visit. Last week we had CMA here visiting, and many people felt at peace, and we've heard that before in our church there. And it's all due to prayer from prayer warriors like Carrie and Janae praying for this church and praying for the Holy Spirit presence to be felt in this church. And I can tell that there has been a change, and it's all due to prayer. And we can do more. We can do more. We can pray more. And that's what we need to do. There are three different things that we saw in this scripture where we could witness that the Holy Spirit was there. One is the fact that they were unified. The church was unified. Spiritually, they were all one. Okay, one mind, one heart. And a church is really like an organism. It's alive, and it's changing. It's evolving. It's moving. And here's the time, you know, of unification. The time of unity is displayed in our time of fellowship. It's displayed in our time of giving. It's displayed in our time of worship. And it's also going to be displayed in our service.
Amen.
Okay. As we start doing more of these outreaches, we start getting out there and serving the Lord together as one body. Yes. Moving out. And the core, it was this, they witnessed, they testified, and as a result, God's grace was so powerful at work in them, because they were doing the Lord's work. They were magnified. God granted them favor with people, okay? As they witnessed, God granted them favor, and people were drawn to them, drawn to the church, drawn to God. Because they were hungry to know who this God is. They're hungry to know who is your God. Why are you so hopeful and I am so distressed? Why are you laughing and I'm crying? Why aren't you miserable like me? Has anybody ever said that to you? Why aren't you as miserable as I am? And misery loves company, right? I'm miserable. I want you to be miserable too. We just seen, and we talked about this before, that early churches grew. It grew 120 to 3,000, then to 5,000, and just multitudes coming. And Carrie was sharing about, and I've seen this before, the revival, it seems like almost everyone is unanimous, and revival is going to take place in the small churches. It's not going to take place in the big churches.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen a lot of writings on that, and people are saying revival is going to take place in the small churches, is where they're seeing it. Testify again. Very simple. When you start working out your witnessing, and this is something we need to work through these evangelism classes, Who were you before you came to the Lord? How did the Lord change your life? And what are you like now? Yeah. So then those are three basic things. Before, now, future. Yeah. Power, the Holy Spirit. I think this is one of those items that we just dismiss so quickly. That so many Christians are not living in the power of the Holy Spirit. So many of us are just willing to just get by. But Jesus said you can have the same power that I have. Power of healing. The power of witnessing. The power of granting favor in our relationships, in our testimonies. The power of multiplication taking place in the church. Now we say this church has the Holy Spirit, but one of the evidences of it is multiplication. And so far we're not really seeing that multiplication yet. So maybe we need to be seeking the Lord more and seeking more of the Spirit in order to see the multiplication factor can take place. Because our God is a God of multiplication, not addition, not subtraction, not division. Multiplication, we see it time and time and again in the Bible. Things being multiplied. Satan, he's division. His whole purpose is to divide. God is to multiply. So just as we talk about unity in the church, Satan's goal was to divide the church. We're divisive. We're divide the marriage. We divide any relationship. God's Spirit filled them, renewed them, gave them power, gave them strength, gave them courage. You know, not talking too much about Barnabas, but this Barnabas that we talk about at the end of the scripture I read, he's the one that encouraged Paul. He's the one that encouraged Mark. Paul gave up on Mark. Mm-hmm. But Barnabas was there. This is our first introduction. Son of encouragement, and he was. And we all need those encouragers. We all need to be encouragers. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church, said, talks about the early church, their loves, their hopes, their passions joined together. Their loves, their hopes, their passions. They were of one. A vibrant community. A community in mission. 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 Witnessing. Mission. What do you give up? What would you be willing to give up for the Lord? Sometimes possessions are easy to give up. Yeah. But what the Lord really wants is our heart. He wants our mind. He wants our soul. He wants our heart to be sold out for Him. That's what He really wants. And then the rest of it flows out naturally. One in spirit, one in mind, having the same love. There's a word for us today. Okay, you can use that, or Wheel of Fortune. No. I think it's pronounced homothymata. Okay, it's a Greek word. And this is what is used in the scripture we're looking at today. And this is what it means. One mind, one accord, together. That's unity. That's unity. E.D. Smith, who was an Old Testament scholar, said, not based on common personal feelings, but on a cause greater than the individual. That's where the church is. We have a cause that's greater than any one of us here. A cause that's greater. To be unified, together, serving together, loving God together. One, mine, together. Does money create obstacles in unity? Yeah, it sure does, doesn't it? Money gets in the way of a lot of things, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. First Timothy says, for the love of money is the root. Not money is the root. Be careful, because that's the way it's misquoted. Mm-hmm. The love of money is a root. We all need money to conduct transactions, to pay our bills and so forth. But it's the love of money. When you make money number one, it becomes divisive. And then we start hoarding, we start keeping to ourselves. And so not only are we not sharing maybe possessions, we're not sharing our heart. We're not sharing love, we're not sharing compassion, we're not sharing anything. Because we're so safely guarded over that money. When money becomes our God, then we just replaced our loving God with something else that gets in the way. Ever, anybody ever hear this Toby Mac song? I love that song. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world yet for lose their soul is the way he sings it, for forfeit their soul? What good is it to have everything? Elvis Presley had everything. He was a miserable man.
Yep.
He couldn't even leave his home. He tried to go out in disguise, and everybody would still recognize him, and mobs would come. I know. I still think back of that Jim Carrey quote I did about a year ago. He said, everybody should become rich and famous so they know that's not the answer.
Amen.
You know, that's what our culture says. If you're rich and famous, you've got everything. Yep. But yet the rich and famous still have holes in their life. Mike Tyson would win $2 million in a prize fight. A year later, he'd be busted broke and be back on the streets again. People, how many people that they've interviewed 5 years after they won the lottery are actually happy? Yeah. There's a woman in England, I think she's 21, suing for winning the lottery because she said it ruined her life. Okay. It ruined her life. So she's suing. We all think, and that's part of culture, being rich and famous is the answer. And I'll tell you, just from my own experiences, every time I got a pay raise or moved up and made more money and spent the money, I thought, oh, if I could just own this truck, I'll be happy. Or if I can just have this, it'll make me happy. Or if I can just have, never made me happy. I just own a Jeep. Yeah, Jeep, that'll. Oh, Alfa Romeo, yeah, I'll be happy now. No, it never did. God is the only source that can fill that void to truly make us satisfied and content. This community life that they had was never an end in and of itself. That was not the goal. Community was not the goal. What was at the core of everything they did? Well, R.K. Harrison said, maintenance of the group was not the primary consideration. Above all, this was a witnessing community. That's what was at the core of everything they did, was witnessing. That's why they enjoyed grace. That's why they enjoyed blessing. Evangelism was always at the core. And as we see here, and Jesus says at the end of the book of Matthew, and this is the call to missions. The missionaries have this on their hearts. Go make disciples. That should be at the core of everything in this church, is how can we go and make disciples? How can we strive to bring others into that relationship with Jesus that we have? We should want that for everyone. And then teach them, lead them. So today we talked about how important prayer is in the church. And it's vital in the church. And if you want the Holy Spirit to work in this church, we have to be praying for it. It doesn't just happen, okay? Unity. And I think this church is becoming more unified. And that's what we need, to be of one mind, of one spirit with God. Grace.
We saw in the early church how they helped one another. They saw somebody in need, they stepped in and helped one another. And I've seen that happen in this church. And we just need that to continue, that we see somebody in need, that we step in and we help them and we love them. And at the core was evangelism, reaching others for Christ. That we need to have the same love of others that Christ has. That when we pray about these people that don't know Christ or that are struggling or are addicted, that our hearts should be broken just like God's heart is broken for them. And we should be crying out for them to be saved from the bondage that they are in. This is a time of invitation. If anybody needs to come up and have prayer, I'll be happy to pray with them. Or Carrie, be happy to pray with them. If there's anything that's touching your heart, it's a time that you can sit and you can meditate and seek God on your own or come up for prayer. How do you want to be remembered? Do you want to be remembered as a man or woman of God that lived your life serving, loving God, serving others? You know, it's not necessarily bad to have a tombstone that says, oh, he was a good father or a good mother, or she was a good mother or a good husband or a good wife. But did you use your life to serve for God? There's a lot of good people, but there's a lot of people that are not saved. This is a time of this close and a word of prayer and with a hymn. And hopefully, I have to admit, I've been overjoyed. I don't sound overjoyed. I'm overjoyed! There. Overjoyed with the response I am seeing from members of this church coming forward and want to serve and want to help. And you can see the love of God in them. You see that they want to do things, you know, to serve God. And to me, that brings a lot of joy to see that. Amen. I thank you for all you that want to do that. And I know there's a few people here that are interested in being part of the worship team, and I'm looking forward to that because I'm getting tired of all the videos, to be quite honest. We probably are too, so it'll be great that we start having that live worship team up here as well. Looking forward to that. So
that doesn't mean y'all can quit singing. Just because we have live music.
Exactly. Let's close in a word of prayer. Lord, we are just so thankful for this word this morning. It's great to see the early church and to see the life that was in that church. A life of worship, a life of giving, a life of serving, a life of loving. Lord, we pray that we just get more of that infused here in this church, in this body, Lord. That we have hearts of service and love for one another. And above all, love for you. Help us to draw closer to you through your word, through time of prayer. We pray that your spirit may grow in this church and your presence will be known by everyone who walks in the door. And that there will just be a peace and there'll be a comfort in knowing that we are in your presence. We pray your spirit will grow and that we are magnified, that you grant us favor, and that the church is multiplied. Just continue to be the church that you have called us out to be, the bride that you have seen.